Okay. So this is part two. I got unceremoniously cut off by my tablet at like the 37 minute mark, and probably I should look at my phone really quick to see. Oh, now I got to do higher math. Okay, so I've got some time. Alrighty, so hopefully I can get through the second half of this really quick. Obviously, I'm not going, ooh, specialty fiber, hold on, dog hair. I'm not going to be able to do the remainder of the questions and then give you a tour. Boy, I'm just dragging that. I'm as bad as TV. Teaser. You're still not going to get to see my stitchy area because this is going to take several hours to download, and then it will be dark. And it is raining in Georgia currently. In North Georgia, we have rain. And I'm also doing this. Usually I do these things in the middle of the night so I don't get interrupted by telephone calls. So inevitably, Dearest will come in from the barn, the dog will come in, the phone will ring numerous times, and we will just muddle through. Okay, so without further ado, we will continue on the Stash Queen's Stash Enhancement tag. And I got about halfway through that. Hold on with me just a second here. Yes, I am running. Excellent. Thought I almost forgot to turn you on. Okay, name one item in your stash that you were unable to purchase after seeing someone else with that item. I think the last one I get if I had too much money, if I had more disposable income, I would have Stash Queen stash size stash. Because I see stuff all the time and go, ooh, I have to have that. But I learned years ago with paper catalogs that, ooh, I have to have that, bend down the page, the corner, and then 2 days later pick up the catalog again and see, did you really, really want that jar opener? You know, or whatever it is. And so very rarely do I... Oh no, I succumb to, don't get me wrong, I don't have will of steel. I do, we enable each other. So what am I doing? Hold on. Okay. Probably the last thing was snow, which was a heaven and earth, is a heaven and earth. And I've showed it before. Let me see if I can get it real quick. Snow is Maxine Gadd, G-A-D-D. Oh, way too big for this. But anyways, that's snow, and it's a heaven and earth. And Maxine Gadd did the artwork, and she is absolutely beautiful. And I saw her beautiful, beautiful face, and I said, I must have that. So I am not without, I'm weak, but really floss is my biggest weakness. Okay, if someone asked you what was the one must-have pattern that they had to have in their stash, which pattern would you recommend? And I'm not gonna be able to really recommend a specific pattern. I'm gonna say that everybody should have something in their stash that they think is beyond them. For me, it's a heaven and earth. I think I'm going not ever gonna finish one, so why should I start it? But I think it's so beautiful, I have to have it. Because I don't mind giving the artist money. I don't mind giving the designer money because I think, oh my goodness, that is just an absolutely gorgeous chart. I must have that in my stash forever. And so I don't really have a problem doing that. But I think everybody should have a pattern that is beyond them. Be it Hardanger, be it a heaven and earth, be it something that you go, takes your breath away, and you just must have it. Because someday, you may actually start it. Okay, if someone asked you what one designer they had to check out to enhance their stash, I do have an opinion on this. And if you haven't checked out Ink Circles, check out Ink Circles. Ink Circles has done, they do a lot with geometrics, patterns, things that that can be done in variegateds and things that can be done in solids. Their use of color is divine. And I think if you are into geometric type shapes, or even if you're not, check out Ink Circles. Okay, just a sec. So we've only had one cup of coffee so far today. It's early in my morning. Ugh. So I'm going to be silly. Oh, for heaven's sakes. Come on. So anyways, when it cut off last night, yeah, there was swearing. But at least it beeped into my ear. And I was able to I didn't ramble on alone. Oh my heavens. Yeah, I should have had more coffee. What am I doing? There we go. Or maybe not. Oh my stars, Lori, what are you doing? Why are you not doing this? All right. My loop start is failing me. All right, where is the loop? Where's the loop? No, you're grabbing the wrong thing. There we go. My goodness. That was clumsy, wasn't it? All right, let's go on to... let's see, I think we got that done. I did get stopped in the middle of... The question that I got stopped on was the name one item that you've purchased, and actually my stitching area has quite a few items. The question is name one item you have purchased that was not meant for cross stitch use that you have repurposed for your craft. I have a couple things here in my world that make my little life easier. So hopefully, teaser, next week, it will be sunny, the room will be clean, and I'll give you the grand tour. Alrighty. Come on, eyeballs, focus. Okay. That was very clumsy. I apologize, people. Alright, so that was the Stash Queens. The stash enhancement tag split into two parts. And lastly, the one that I'm going to do today is Carolina S's The Fun Little Tag. Okay, so how do you arrange the floss you are using on a project? Okay, right now I'm doing Noah's Sub, and there's a lot of different colors. And that little bird right there had 10 different colors in it. So there's a multitude of colors. And I use Trisha, the left-handed stitcher's floss cards in just regular Walmart snack baggies, and have them in photo boxes, which I'll show you next time. So right now, because I'm sitting in my stitchy spot and my floss cabinet is 5 feet away, I just sort of kind of, when I go to the, like I've been pulling colors for specific animals. So I will just back up and sit in front of the floss cabinet and pull the colors that I need. So what I've been doing is I have them in the floss away bags, and I have just written the symbol and put the number on, because I have a gazillion floss away bags now. And then I just leave them hanging on my stand here. I have two pegs that allow me to, so I have two different bundles right now of floss, and I don't even close up the baggie. I just leave the baggie open and stuff the floss in there, and it works just fine. What I have used on like a kit, or one of the last pieces I did, the Jiffy kit, had a lot of blended threads. So you had to put two of them together to go into the, to blend them. And so what I did is when I got to that color that I was working, I just put a lot of them together. And then I hung them on my, what is it called, Peco? Let me grab it. Peco. It's this one. Oh, I don't know if you can see it, but it's that. So the nice thing about this is you could put the little symbol on there if you wanted to. This rubbery stuff, you can, oh, I even have a, here's a needle right here. I have a needle stuck in the foam. So I just loop different colors. This happens to be the Erica Michaels chart that I'm working on, so I just have those. I can visually see the difference in those colors, and so like the thing holds, I don't know, 50 colors, 50, it's got 50 pegs, so I just space out my colors. I know which one is which. But you can actually, it comes with little cards that you could actually draw the symbol on, and makes thread organizing a little easier. When I, you know, this Noah's sub, I'm going to have probably 60, 70 colors pulled when I'm done. So I'm not pulling them out all at one time. I'm just pulling them out as I need them. Because I'm lazy. And I just may wander away from this. This may bore me and I may stop, and then I would have all those colors out, and that would be silly. Okay, have you attempted to dye fabric? If so, what method did you use? If not, is there any particular method you would want to try? Actually, I have no burning desire to do my own... Oh, the dryer's done. To do my own dyeing. I think there are enough people out there that do a fine job without me. Yes, I don't buy much because different fabrics take dyes so differently. I really like to see what I'm buying when it comes to dyed fabrics. So I only buy dyed fabrics through a brick and mortar, I'm standing there, shop. So do I have any burning desire to make a mess in my house and dye stuff? No. I'll leave that to the people who obviously know what they're doing. Okay. If you use a needle threader, is there any specific type you prefer? Yes. I prefer the Clover needle threader. It has two bands instead of a wire. Well, actually, I think it's bent. I think it's one wire just bent over. So this is a Clover. I bought this at a, you can get it on 123 Stitch. I bought it at Joann's, I think, or Michael's, a box store. Okay, Clover is a brand that is fairly readily available here in the States, but you can buy one of these at 123 Stitch. I'm not using it very often, but it is sitting right here where I can get to it. If you use any type of frame to stitch, do you stitch with the fabric over the frame or in the well? I stitch in the well. When I'm using my hoop, when I grab my hoop, I flip over the fabric. If it's in the well, how am I going to explain this? If it's in the well, and then I flip the fabric over and I'm holding the hoop by the fabric, by the back side of the fabric, to keep it as clean as possible. So I stitch in the well. Do I do that all the time? I do now for some reason. I don't know why I didn't for years and years, but I do now. Okay, do you start your threads in the front or the back of your projects? What methods do you use? Well, you saw a very poor example of a front loop method. I have lately been doing the pinhead stitch because I've been working on a lot of linen, and that's not real conducive to traveling very far. So I don't want to see my stitches from back, or stitches through the back, through the back side. So I've been doing the pinhead stitch. I did that. I'm doing that a lot with that Erica Michaels project that I'm doing that I'm not going to be able to show you because it's, well, we're on the other side of the room. So I have done a waist knot. I've done all of them. I've done a waist knot, a loop, start, a pinhead stitch, and I have also run, though I have not done that in a long time, I used to run my thread on the backside. I'm going to tell you something about the loop method. Now, my friend Gay, who is a fiber artist in her own right, is appalled at the loop method. Because she says, and I believe her, that the floss is twisted in one direction, okay? So when you have the twist in this direction, and then you loop it over, then you have the twist in that direction. So it actually, I don't know, it's not as shiny as, if you looked under a microscope, I'm sure it would matter. It doesn't matter to me. So there. Hope that just went, that tangent probably didn't make any sense to anybody whatsoever. If she just doesn't like the loop method. She thinks it affects the sheen of the thread. I don't have that problem. Okay, let's see. If you are a gritter, what is your preferred method of gritting? I am like MN Chaos. I cannot use a chemical pen on my stitching. You may not be able to see it, but there might be chemical residue left behind, and 20 years from now, 20 years from now, I don't want to see it. I don't want to see the grid lines. So currently I'm using Silky sliver. This is a piece of silky sliver. Oh, here's my roll. Silky sliver. Isn't that pretty? That just makes me go, oh. So it lays flat, can't be pierced through with your needle, and comes in spectacular colors. What is your favorite ways to finish projects? Right now, I am on a frame it kick. I am not a sewer. I like to have things. I would not make something into a pillow. I have dogs. I would much prefer to have a behind glass. Picture on my wall. So that is my preferred method. Oh, and by the way, I went to Michael's to go get a mat for Peaceful Forest that I had framed. Oh my goodness, are they proud of their mats. So just another reason why I should start doing my own. It's going to be the most expensive part. That mat is going to be the most expensive part of that piece. Period. Okay. What was your first cross-stitching milestone? I have no idea. I would have to say, because I was a model stitcher, and some of my stuff went on the actual leaflet. I would think that would have to be my milestone. I would have to say that would have to be it, because I've been stitching since the late 80s. So, not constant, on and off. So that was probably a milestone, seeing my stuff in print. What is a stitch goal you have? Something you want to conquer? Oh, I don't have any goals. Conquer. Goals. Probably clean out the rest of the stuff that I know I'm not going to use. I have, I'm in a purge phase. So right now I'm getting rid of all my needlepoint cottons and pearls. And I have beautiful silk and wool skeins and just absolutely, want to rub your face on it stuff. And I came to the realization when I got that the silk one, that's eBay silk, that I may do canvas work again, but I'm not gonna have canvas work stash anymore. I'll just have I'll just go and buy it. I'll just beautiful, beautiful stuff. Not gonna use it. Should give it, sell it, whatever, to someone who will use it. I may put it on Craigslist. I may just take it to the thrift store. So is that a goal and something you want to conquer? Yes, I have I want to conquer the volume of stuff that I have to put it under control. What's your silliest duh stitch moment? Probably when I went loop start. How could any, what, where, how, where have I been that I didn't know this was going on? So yeah, the loop method is without a doubt the silliest duh moment in stitching. Let's see, where are we? If you use paper charts, do you print them at home or use a service? I have one of those 3-in-1 printer fax thingies. So I use that. I can print from my laptop to it. I can go and enlarge stuff. I can make working copies. It's definitely is. Hold on, gotta concentrate. What am I doing? Okay. Definitely, I have the luxury of owning a fax copier printer thingy. So I do it at home. How do you mark off your paper charts if you use them? Okay, Stitching May turned me on to Corinor dry marker pencils. They came, I got them at Hobby Lobby, I think, and they came 6 in a pack, I think it was. So Corinor makes pens and pencils. When I was a drafter, I had a bunch of Corinor ink pens. It's a company that's been around quite some time. It's called a dry marker. And it's just your basic sharp, you know, use a pencil sharpener to sharpen it. Comes in colors. Happen to have three of them here, so I have yellow, pink, and blue. So dry markers is what they're called. So she turned me on to those. Good job. Thank you much, Lee. Okay, because I can't be remember slob klutzy, slob and klutzy should not have something like a marker, because I am liable to drop it on my fabric. I don't trust me anymore. Come on, get in there. I have a Sharpie here. I love Sharpies. Not as much as floss, but I do love Sharpies. And Sharpies are something that I use a lot at work. And so I have one here that I use to put the numbers and the symbols on my floss away bags. And I back up from my work 5 feet. Okay, that's an exaggeration. 2 feet. So that if I was to drop that Sharpie, I would just mark me and not my work. That was a tangent. Okay, where are we now? Is there a cross stitch book you suggest? What I suggest you get is, and there are numbers of them out there. There's like, 200 2-hour stitches and, 500 motifs. Get something like that. That is very handy for cards. That is very handy for putting a little cross stitch thing on a bib, to give away as a shower present. And there are numerous ones out there. Find one that you like. 500 motifs for all seasons. There's dozens of them out there. Pick up one of those. I think it's a wonderful thing to have. If you lose your stitchy bug and you'd say, oh, maybe I should just do a little something. It's a little book. It'll give you a little projects, little quickie projects so that you can feel like you've accomplished something. Is there anything that you find that you are very nitpicky about when you cross stitch? Nitpicky? No, I don't like leaving mistakes. I just don't like leaving mistakes. I don't know if that's nitpicky. I don't think there's really any nitpickiness. I do have an issue. People come into my house, and if my cross stitch is up, they want to touch it. It's like, get on, dirt. Keep your dirty, greasy little paws off my stitching. So yeah, I really have probably scarred small children for life. I'm not that bad. Favorite LNS you visited while on a trip? Okay, probably my favorite, and you have to understand that I don't do a whole lot of traveling, but Silk Road in St. Petersburg, Florida, you walk into the front and it's all, there's all painted canvases. It's both needlepoint and cross stitch. So don't get disheartened when you walk in, because all you see is needlepoint, and then silk flosses and beautiful things on. Oh yes, floss. I get distracted. But it's needlepoint in the front, and it's cross stitch in the back. And when you step in the back, there are not many samples on the walls, but there are tubs and tubs and tubs of charts. I mean, Angel sang. Went back there and it was like, oh my goodness. And I spent 2 solid days back there. I went one day and I said, and whatever day it was, he wasn't open on Monday. And I said, okay, see you on Tuesday. And I came back and I went through it again. I had such a delightful time. He's a very nice gentleman. I'm sorry, I cannot remember his name right off the top of my head, the owner of the shop. He is very, very pleasant. And they're stitching. He has tables in the front where people can stitch. And then beautiful hand-painted canvases on the walls. And then if you go in the back is the cross stitch. So that's probably the most fun I've had in a local needlework shop to date. Okay, is there anything that you do that takes up a lot of time when you cross stitch but that is worth it in the end? I don't bobbinate. No. I mean, cross stitching for me is a slow process. I am not a fast stitcher. As you can see, we're just plugging along here at Noah's Sub. It will take me years at this pace, and I'm not real concerned about it. So I don't... probably whipping the edges of my fabric if they're not... they're not serged. That way that you don't get the fraying, that would be the only thing that I can think of that I do, is if I get a piece of fabric that needs to be, the edges are raw, then I whip stitch the edges. Oh, and it's ugly. It's not pretty. It just is, you know, keeping the little frayed bits in check. Okay, that was it. That was Carolina S, the fun little tag. And I'm going to stop real quick. See how many minutes I got left. Oh, we're almost done. We're like at 32 minutes. So that was good timing on my part. So next time we talk, I will show you my stitching area. I apologize. It is overcast in Georgia, and this is, I did not realize I was going to get cut off last night. So this will... probably take 4 or 5 hours to download, and then it will definitely be dark and we won't be able to do Stitchy Spot anyways. But hopefully we'll do Stitchy Spot within a couple weeks. And teaser, 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 thank you for watching, thank you for subscribing, I appreciate all of you. I enjoy watching everybody else. I am so far behind. I am over 100 videos behind. Isn't that horrible? But I just don't have time. And I want to see every single one of you. So if I don't comment, it doesn't mean I didn't see it. It just means I'm having trouble responding to my own comments. But I do read your comments. I thank everybody for watching. It is very sweet and nice and wonderful that you all like me and want to hear me blather on about a hobby, a craft that we all love. So I'm gonna pause here, rotate my laundry, do some vacuuming, and then sit down and stitch some more. So thank you all for hanging out with me. Get lots of stitching done. Thanks a lot. Talk soon. Bye.